I'm thinking about the word crush, and how you were my first, and how the worst thing that could have happened when you and I were 10, and made the work together on a grade 5 presentation about animals. I was so nervous. Without ever having met you, I began to reminisce about how you fell in love with me. It was your typical love story. School is attacked by zombie dinosaurs. And Shy Kid saves the day. I think about the way I was when I was younger. About how my hunger for acceptance drove me to cannibalize my fantasies of love into loneliness, believing everyone else would have to die just for you to love me. But in a role reversal I never expected, you fingertip drew halos around the heads of snow angels you saved me. Alone, together in the back of a library, we studied each animal's secret society and learned the use of the collective noun. Example, a murder of crows. God knows it sounds ominous, but this is how I learned about community. We have names for the groupings that occur even in the open ocean. A battery of barracuda, a shiver of sharks, a school of fish. And I pondered the philosophy, since barracudas and sharks are technically fish, wouldn't the term school of fish encapsulate them as well? It wasn't long before you went on to tell me that each term was in some way meant to suggest the nature of each beast. A destruction of wild cats, a crash of rhinoceroses. This is not meant to say that each animal is considered in some way deadly. There are those who sound downright lovely. A murmuration of starlings, a kindle of kittens, an exaltation of larks. Some are meant to sound industrious or prestigious, a parliament of owls, a labor of moles. But I feel for the outcasts, a smack of jellyfish, an implausibility of wildebeest, an apology of Canadians. You love the classification of cowardice of curs. Believe this is where the term underdog stems from. That sometimes we become more than the definitions that are thrust upon us that we can bite back. That a pack of wolves is part of our ancestry. And the moment we embrace our history, we become a new destiny. We can rewrite a legacy because we are a storytelling of ravens. I began applying this concept to my life, arriving at the conclusion that dickheads congregate in groups. And I cannot describe the solemn pride that was mine when I arrived home with a report card that read, "Shame does not work well in groups." I told you this and we both laughed. Maybe it was my happiness that gave me away. Betrayed my position to the three boys who made a hobby out of making me cry. I still remember the impact from when they pushed me over in my chair, and you could have just sat there. I wouldn't have been angry. But instead, you decided to teach me that assholes come in bunches. I learned this fact at the back of that library. You helped me up off the ground and turn around to tell my attackers, "You guys are a bunch of assholes." We were 10. If you ever want to know how it feels to be saved, just let someone save you. Let someone rescue the smile drowning inside you. It's not too late, I swear. See, I once hid my heart in a hat and pulled out a rabbit that ran away just so I could say it was a vanishing act. Ta-da. But through you, I learned real magic is about making things come back. I know, because when a 10-year-old girl can go on to shock 3 bullies into silence, you know you have just determined your lifelong definition of beautiful. And all of the other wonderful instances in your existence will volunteer to dim their brilliance so that throughout your life this moment will shine brightest. You made the best snow angels. Laid them out in trees like paper dolls holding hands. You laid them side by side and said it was because even 2 people can feel alone. I think of the time I would have destroyed the world just so I could be with you. I've grown up since then. But think often of a time when I placed a penny on top of a penny on top of a railroad track. Then waited for a train to squish one coin into the other so I could give you a 2-cent piece, because you were scared that someday they'd raise the price of 1-cent candies. These are the ways I loved you. You were the only one to give me a card on Valentine's Day. Granted, you gave one to everyone. But hard to believe you gave the best one to me. And the other boys were jealous of a small card with a picture of a shark biting a heart, saying, "I think you're awesome." I wanted to draw you a card of a crab pinching a heart, saying, "I think you're crabulous." My granddad advised me against it, citing that in my teens I would understand why that's not true. And now, every time I see a lone snow angel, I think of you. So I offer you now a crush of hearts, a sacrifice of body parts laid upon the altar of better times, when the lines inside of a coloring book were only suggestions. Girl, sometimes you gotta scribble. Gotta color the sun purple just so you know what it feels like to be in charge. Sometimes you gotta love just a little so you can finally start to live large. I offer you a lifetime of held breaths, a juggernaut of thank yous, a thimble of blues and a who's who of I miss yous, because I am made up of memories. And these are the diamonds I have kept polished just so I know what it feels like to treasure something. I've been thinking about the word crush and how you were my first. And how the worst thing that could have happened, happened when you turned 11 and moved away. Didn't even get to say goodbye, because you moved in the summer, and I returned to a school where your absence echoed in my ears for all the years I had left to deal with what it feels like to be alone. I've grown up since then. But think often of a time when we were 10. When you made snow angels hold hands, laid them down side by side, and I tied my definition of beauty to your memory. We never even kissed, because you probably never knew. But goddamn, girl, I had the biggest crush on you.